Hello all. So now let's discuss about the MCQ revision series of kidney in our Dr. Ankit pharmacology series. So in this renal system, we have to discuss about the drugs which are known as diuretics and the drugs which are acting on ADH hormone, that is antidiuretic hormone, which are similar to ADH hormone and which are blockers of ADH hormones. Okay. So before starting with the MCQ, let's discuss about a brief introduction to what are the different diuretics we have. Now, the first class of diuretic we have, diuretic, they will prevent the absorption of sodium in the kidney and they will cause loss of this sodium as well as water into the urine. So let's see how sodium gets reabsorbed in kidney. Suppose 100 molecules of sodium are filtered from glomerulus, they go into PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, and around 60% or 2/3 of the sodium gets reabsorbed back into the blood by an enzyme known as carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So here sodium gets reabsorbed with negatively charged ions like bicarbonate. So the first diuretic we have which will cause loss of this sodium and bicarbonate in urine will be carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. The drug will be acetazolamide. Then this loop after PCT, this part of the kidney, nephron, it goes, descends downward. It is known as descending limb of Henle. Here, remember, it is impermeable to sodium water. Water, only water gets reabsorbed. Then it ascends upwards. It goes into the medulla and then it ascends upwards and it forms thick ascending limb. In the medullary portion, there is a transporter known as sodium potassium 2 chloride transporter, which absorbs 25% of the sodium, and this is inhibited by loop diuretic in medulla. Then cortical portion of thick ascending limb and early part of distal convoluted tubule or DCT, which is also known as cortical diluting segment. Here around 10% of the sodium is reabsorbed with the help of sodium chloride symporter. And thiazides, they inhibit this transporter, hence the sodium will be lost out in urine. While in late part of the DCT and in collecting duct cortical portion, yellow portion is the cortical portion, aldosterone hormone is responsible for absorption of sodium. And when sodium is absorbed, potassium and hydrogen-like ion, they sacrifice. Here, 2% of the sodium is reabsorbed. And this aldosterone action is inhibited by potassium-sparing diuretic because the sodium will be lost out in urine and the potassium will be spared. While in medullary portion of this collecting duct, remember only water is reabsorbed with the help of ADH hormone, antidiuretic hormone. So this is the summary of the effects of diuretic. Diuretic, what ions they will lose out in urine? Remember, all of them will lose sodium into the urine. The drug which loses maximum sodium in the urine will be the most effective diuretic. Hence, they are also known as high efficacy or high ceiling diuretic. And the most efficacious or most high ceiling diuretic is loop diuretic, followed by osmotic. And the least efficacious diuretic is potassium sparing. Okay? So remember, this is the blood levels of all these drugs. So how to remember? Remember, loop loses all ions. With loop, you are seeing all the ions will be lost out in urine. Thiazides also loses all ion except calcium. They will preserve calcium. Potassium sparing, apart from sodium, they will preserve all. And carbonic anhydrase, remember, they increase H plus level in the blood because they cause bicarbonate loss in urine. Hence, what will happen? They will cause alkaline urine. Okay, so this is the summary. Now, let's start with the first diuretic, that is carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. They are sulfonamide. That is why they all end with the word amide. Okay, and they are non-competitive reversible inhibitor. They are used in all these conditions, game plan, glaucoma, for alkalinization of urine, mountain sickness, epilepsy and periodic paralysis. And the drugs are acetazolamide, methazolamide, dorzolamide, brinzolamide. Why they are ending with the word amide? Because they are sulfonamide. So these are their side effects also. They cause bone marrow suppression. Remember, this is the only class of diuretic which causes bone marrow suppression, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. They cause ammonia retention. Why? Because ammonia require acidic urine and they turn the pH of urine alkaline. Hence, ammonia will not be excreted out in urine. The problem will arise in those patients in which liver failure is there, because liver normally converts ammonia into urea, non-toxic substance. So in liver failure, this ammonia can damage brain, which can lead to encephalopathy. It is contraindicated in sulfa allergy because they are sulfonamide. Electrolyte imbalance, they cause hyperchloremic, hypokalemic, metabolic acidosis. And they cause paresthesia, altered taste, and diarrhea. So keeping this thing in mind, let's solve the questions now. Okay? So the first question is asking, acetazolamide is, we remember acetazolamide is a non-competitive, generally non-competitive inhibitors are irreversible inhibitor, but this is an exception that acetazolamide is a non-competitive reversible inhibitor of carbonic anhydrase enzyme. So it's a very unique property. Generally non-competitive are irreversible, but it is a reversible. The carbonic anhydrase inhibitor should not be given in. So we already know sulfa allergy. It's absolutely true. They should not be given. So they should not be given in sulfa allergy. True. Glaucoma, it's false. Remember, they are used in glaucoma game plan. High altitude sickness, false. They are given in mountain sickness. Metabolic acidosis, true. Because they retain H plus ion in the blood. In the blood, they increase H plus ion. While there will be bicarbonate loss in urine. Okay. Hence, these drugs, remember, carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause metabolic acidosis. Okay. Hence, they should not be given. Remember, in COPD, the patient has respiratory failure, which causes metabolic acidosis due to hypoxia, due to retention of CO2. Hence, they are absolutely contraindicated in COPD. And hirsutism, false. Okay. So, remember this part. Because in COPD, metabolic acidosis is seen. Because of hypoxia and retention of CO2, remember CO2 is an acidic gas. It causes metabolic acidosis. Which of the following diuretic can result in metabolic acidosis? So I'll just show you that summary. If you see that summary, the diuretic which increases H plus ion in the body are carbonic anhydrase enzyme and potassium sparing diuretic. So only these two diuretics can cause metabolic acidosis in the blood. They increase H plus ion. H plus is an acidic ion. So try to find an acidic drug, acetazolamide like drug. So the answer out here is acetazolamide. Remember, indapamide is a thiazide. Furosemide is a loop diuretic and chlorothiazide is again thiazide. Remember, thiazides and loop, they cause alkalosis, not acidosis. Okay? Because they cause H plus loss in urine. Which of the following statement is not true about diuretics? So let's see. Acetazolamide is a carbonic anhydrase stimulant. It's absolutely false. It is rather a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Okay, it is rather a inhibitor of carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Thiazides act on cortical diluting segment. It's absolutely true. Cortical diluting segment is the cortical part of thick ascending limb and early part of DCT, distal convoluted tibule. We have already discussed. It's absolutely true. Furosemide is a high ceiling diuretic. It's absolutely true. Loop diuretic is an example of high ceiling furosemide. Spironolactone is an aldosterone antagonist. We will discuss those drugs shortly. Now, drugs that can be used to produce alkalinization of urine. So we have already discussed that carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, they cause loss of bicarbonate ion into the urine. They cause alkalinization of urine game plan. Okay. So the answer is acetazolamide. Because they cause bicarbonate loss in urine. And remember, bicarbonate change the pH of urine alkaline. Okay. Now, acetazolamide side effect, all of the following except. We have discussed everything. It causes hypokalemia. It's absolutely true. Okay. It causes hypokalemia in the blood. It's absolutely true. Okay. It causes diarrhea. It's absolutely true. It causes paresthesia. It's absolutely true. Although it may cause drowsiness also, but you will go by this answer. It's a wrongly framed question, but it was asked in some exam. But the answer you will go by drowsiness. But remember, actually it causes drowsiness also. But the incidence of drowsiness is very less. Acetazolamide can be used in all of the following except. We have already discussed that mnemonic game plan. Acetazolamide is used in glaucoma to reduce aqueous humor production. It causes alkalinization of urine. Why in acidic drug poisoning we do? We give in mountain sickness. It is the drug of choice. It is used in epilepsy and periodic paralysis. Okay, so the incorrect answer you are finding out here is cirrhosis of liver. Remember, acetazolamide is absolutely contraindicated in liver failure because it causes retention of ammonia. Ammonia will not be converted into urea because of liver failure. It can lead to hyperammonemic encephalopathy. So remember, in liver failure, cirrhotic failure, acetazolamide is absolutely contraindicated. Now, drug causing metabolic acidosis, the answer, best answer out here is acetazolamide. Okay, but remember, spironolactone can also cause it. It is a potassium sparing diuretic, but you will go by this answer. Okay, now true regarding acetazolamide is, it's an irreversible inhibitor of carbonic. No, it is rather a reversible inhibitor, not irreversible. It is a rather reversible inhibitor. The structure resembles to sulfonamide. It's absolutely true, we have discussed. That is why they are ending with the word amide. It decreases sodium potassium glucose excretion. It's absolutely false. It rather increases it, sodium and potassium excretion. It causes metabolic alkalosis. It's false. It rather causes acidosis. Okay, acidosis. Now let's talk about certain points about loop diuretics. So we know that loop diuretic will be acting in medullary portion of thick ascending limb. So what are the drugs we have among loop diuretics? These are the drugs we have among loop diuretics. Okay. So some of the loop diuretics are mercury containing drugs like ethacrynic acid and mursalil. They have been rarely used now. Most of them have been banned also because they are highly ototoxic drug. They can cause permanent deafness or hearing loss. Then we meet certain sulfur containing like furosemide, torsemide and bumetanide. But these drugs, they can increase ototoxicity of other drugs. Longest is torsemide, most potent is bumetanide. 100% oral bioavailability or absorption is of ethacrynic acid. Now they are used in edema and they are the drug of choice in edema. So these are the various drugs we used in different edema. But remember, at the last option, we have to give loop diuretics only. Okay, then what are the side effects? Remember, loop loses all ions in the urine. Hence, the blood level of all these ions will reduce. So it will cause loss of sodium, which can lead to hyponatremia and hypotension. It causes hypokalemia, which can lead to muscle cramp and digoxin. Calcium loss. Remember, calcium loss is minimal seen because intestine compensates for calcium loss. Hypomagnesemia, which can lead to chondrocalcinosis or pseudogout, metabolic acidosis. Now, because of loss of all these ions, there will be hyperglycemia in blood, hyperlipidemia and hyperuricemia, which will tend to maintain the osmotic pressure in the blood. Okay. Now, if you compare them with thiazide, remember, thiazide also loses everything, all electrolyte imbalance. Thiazides also causes hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia, hyperuricemia. But remember, among them, there is one difference. Thiazides, they preserve calcium. They don't lose calcium into the urine. They just preserve calcium. And hence, instead of hypocalcemia, thiazides will cause hypercalcemia. And remember, thiazides and spironolactone, they cause erectile dysfunction or impotency, which is not caused by the loop diuretic. Okay. So these are the various thiazides which we will be discussing shortly. So let's talk about regarding true statement about furosemide or loop diuretic is, it is indicated in acute pulmonary edema. It's absolutely true. I'll tell you the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. Okay, it act on PCT. It's absolutely false. Okay, it rather acts on thick ascending limb in medullary portion, not in. It causes mild diuresis. Remember, it false. It is a high ceiling diuretic. It causes massive diuresis. Okay. It is only given by parenteral route. No, it is given by all routes. Oral, parenteral, like intravenous, intramuscular, etc. So the answer is, it is given in acute pulmonary edema. So let's talk about the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. Remember, for acute pulmonary edema, we give venodilators. Okay, we give venodilators for acute pulmonary edema. Acute pulmonary edema is also sometimes known as acute left ventricular failure, because in acute left ventricular failure, acute pulmonary edema is seen. So the treatment is LMNOP. This is the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. L for loop diuretics. Remember, why they are used in here in acute pulmonary edema, it is not because of their diuretic action. Remember, they increase prostaglandin synthesis. And this prostaglandin causes venodilatation. Then we add morphine. Morphine also is a venodilator because it can cause histamine release. Then we give nitroglycerin. Nitroglycerin is also a venodilator. It causes nitric oxide production. We give oxygen and we make the patient on proper position. We don't tell the patient to lie down. So this is the treatment of acute pulmonary edema. Okay. Now, as you are seeing that loop diuretic, they have effect by increase in prostaglandin synthesis. Remember, there is a class of drug which inhibit prostaglandin synthesis, that is known as NSAIDs. NSAIDs or loop, or you will write one very important NSAID, that is aspirin. All NSAIDs include aspirin. Remember, they reduce the antihypertensive effect. They reduce the antihypertensive or the effect of diuretics. Remember, NSAIDs, they reduce the effect of diuretic because NSAIDs, they have anti-diuretic property. They reduce prostaglandin production because most of the diuretic, they have their diuretic action because of prostaglandin production as well. Now, most potent loop diuretic, I hope we have already discussed that part, that is bumetanide. Both loop and thiazides can cause hypokalemia by. Now, remember why hypokalemia occurs. As you can see, that when, suppose carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, loop and thiazides, which are acting on PCT, medullary portion and cortical portion, when they cause sodium loss, remember this sodium is delivered to the collecting duct and the body will try to compensate it. So they compensate for this sodium and there will be potassium loss. Hence, the point is when we will give this diuretic, the body will compensate in collecting ducts. Because of this reason, there will be massive potassium loss in urine. They cause hypokalemia. Okay. So the answer for this question is try to find out they inhibit proximal tubular potassium reabsorption. It's false. They don't do in PCT. Inhibit sodium potassium cotransporter in ascending loop. It's absolutely false. It is only by loop diuretic, not by thiazides. Proximal, remember, it is only by carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Increasing the availability of sodium in distal tubular fluid to exchange with the potassium. Okay, this answer is absolutely true. Because if this sodium will be delivered to the collecting duct, the body will try to compensate. They potentiate the action of aldosterone. It's absolutely false. They are not having potentiating action of aldosterone. So the answer is they increase the availability of sodium in distal tubular fluid. And distal tubular fluid will compensate for this sodium loss by excreting out potassium. Now, indomethacin can antagonize the diuretic action of loop. Remember, indomethacin is an NSAID. Okay. So, indomethacin is a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And let's see how it can. All non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they prevent prostaglandin mediated. Try to find this word, prostaglandin. Okay. So, they inhibit prostaglandin mediated diuresis. Loop diuretic, they increase prostaglandin production also, which increases glomerular filtration rate, which causes diuresis. Furosemide should not be administered with NSAID. Again, the reason is NSAID will inhibit prostacyclin synthesis. Okay. All of the following diuretic inhibit sodium potassium 2-chloride transimporter except. Remember here, loop diuretic inhibit. Loop diuretic, they inhibit this symporter. So, furosemide is a loop diuretic, it's true. Ethacrynic acid again, mursalil, true. We have already discussed, the answer is thiazides. Drug causing deafness, again, ethacrynic acid, we have discussed. Furosemide can cause all of the following except. Remember, loop loses all. So, it will cause loss of magnesium, it's absolutely true. Loss of potassium, true. When this electrolyte will be lost, we have discussed, it will lead to hyperglycemia. It is absolutely true. Remember, they don't cause acidosis. Because of H plus loss, it will rather cause alkalosis. Okay. So, acidosis is mainly caused by carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, not by loop and thiazides. Loop diuretic act on thick ascending limb of Henle. In which portion? In medullary portion. Okay. Loop diuretics such as furosemide act by? They act by. So the answer for this question is they inhibit sodium potassium 2 chloride co-transporter in medullary thick ascending limb. Furosemide is Eustachian. We have already discussed refractory edema. Okay. Treatment of hypercalcemia includes all of the following. So if you talk about the treatment of hypercalcemia, what is the treatment? Let's see. So the treatment of hypercalcemia is, first step is to give profuse saline. So we give IV 0.9% NaCl. It is given around 2 to 4 liters. Then we give loop diuretic. Why? Because loop loses all. It will cause calcium loss in urine. And when the patient becomes stabilized, we either give calcitonin or we will give bisphosphonates. Calcitonin and bisphosphonates will lead this blood calcium, they will cause this calcium to get deposited in bones. Okay, hence the blood calcium level will reduce. So the first step is to give profuse saline and with loop diuretics. After that, you can add calcitonin and bisphosphonate. This is the treatment of hypercalcemia. So the answer for this question must be all of the above. Okay, sorry, all are following can be given except. So the question is asking except, sorry. So remember, loop diuretics, yes, they are given. Calcitonin, yes, they are given. Remember, thiazides are not given. So the answer is thiazides. Remember, thiazides, their side effect is hypercalcemia. Thiazide, they themselves can cause hypercalcemia because thiazides, they preserve calcium. So the side effect of thiazide is hypercalcemia. Now, hypomagnesemia due to increased excretion by the kidney is caused all of the following by except. Okay. So the answer for this question number 14, remember, is digitalis. Remember digitalis. Remember furosemide, it causes loss in urine. Okay. It causes loss of in urine, aminoglycoside loss in urine, cisplatin also loss in urine. They all damage kidney. They are nephrotoxic drug, they damage. But remember, digitalis can also cause hypomagnesemia. It's absolutely yes. But it causes hypomagnesemia because of movement of this magnesium, not lost by the kidney, it is rather into the cell. Okay. It is rather into the cell it can cause. Okay. Free water clearance is decreased by, remember, free water clearance is decreased by diuretics. That is, diuretic you are finding here is furosemide. So you can access a whole concept of free water clearance on our video, and it has been posted on group as well. Now, hypercalcemia is caused by all of the following except. Now, hypercalcemia caused by all of the following except. Remember, thiazides, true, they cause. Vitamin D can also cause hypercalcemia. Lithium also causes. We know that loop loses all. All ions into the urine. Hence, loop will rather cause hypocalcemia. Okay? Loop will cause hypocalcemia. Regarding furosemide, true statement is, acute pulmonary is an indication, true. It acts on PCT, mild diuresis, false. So this is the treatment. Most common complication of loop diuretic is, among them, is hypokalemia. It is the most common. Hypocalcemia, rarely seen. Why? Intestine compensates for calcium loss. Intestine will start to absorb more amount of calcium. Remember, it does not cause hypercalcemia. It does not cause hyperkalemia. It also only causes loss of ions in urine. So now let's talk about thiazides. So we know where thiazides are acting, in cortical portion of thick ascending limb and in early part of DCT. Okay. Now thiazides, remember, they cause loss of all ions except calcium in the urine. So they preserve calcium. Hence they are good for bones because they cause hypercalcemia, bone growth will occur. So they're good in osteoporotic patient. Now the drugs among thiazides we have are Remember, are these drugs thiazides or thiazide-like? Thiazides, they will end with the word thiazide. You don't have to cram, just try to identify a word thiazide. And thiazide-like, either they will end with the word on or they will end with the word amide. So chlorthalidone, metalozone, indapamide, zipamide, clopamide. Longest is chlorthalidone, most potent is indapamide. Shortest and least potent is, which will require most doses, chlorthiazide. 100% bioavailability is benzoflumethiazide. And the only thiazide which is effective in metalozone, in renal failure, is metalozone. But remember, drug of choice as a diuretic in renal failure is loop diuretics. Okay. So they are also used in diabetes insipidus, and this is the treatment of diabetes insipidus, which we will be discussing shortly. Okay. So let's, keeping this thing in mind, let's solve the question. Now thiazides cause all of the following except. So we have to find an except statement. They cause hyperglycemia, true. They cause increased urinary excretion, it's absolutely false. Remember, thiazides preserve calcium. Okay. They are used in CHF, yes, we have already discussed the treatment of edema. They decrease uric acid excretion, it's absolutely true. They cause hyperglycemia, they cause hyperuricemia, they are used in edema. Okay. Now, which of the following is not associated with thiazide? They cause hypercalciuria, it's absolutely false. Remember, they are rather used for the treatment of hypercalciuria. They are rather used for the treatment of hypercalciuria because they preserve calcium. Hyponatremia, true. Rest, all other ions are lost. When the ions are lost, the level of uric acid, glucose and lipid in the blood will increase to maintain the osmolarity. A 50-year-old man has a history of frequent episode of renal colic with high calcium. So, can you tell me which diuretic will reduce the calcium excretion into the urine, which can be given for the treatment of renal stone? Is thiazides. Remember, thiazides, they are used for the treatment of renal stones, which are formed by calcium. Okay, which are formed by calcium. Why? Because they inhibit excretion of calcium into the urine. So try to find a drug which is a thiazide. This is the answer. Which of the following diuretic cause hypercalcemia and can be used in recurrent renal calcium stone? The answer is thiazides. So the answer out here is, try to find a thiazide, chlorthiazide. Thiazide diuretic does not cause. They cause hypercalcemia, it's absolutely true. They preserve calcium. They cause hypomagnesemia, it's absolutely true because they cause loss of all ions. They cause hyperkalemia, it's false. Remember, they cause hypokalemia. They cause hyperuricemia, it's absolutely true. So I'll just show you the list of side effects again. So this is the complete list. Loop loses all, which can loss of all ions, which can lead to hyperglycemia, hyperlipidemia, and hyperuricemia. While thiazide, they will just preserve calcium among them. Rest, everything is same. Thiazide and spironolactone will cause impotency. Okay. Now, side effect of thiazides may include, it causes hypokalemia, true. Hyperuricemia, true. Hyperglycemia, true. The answer is all of the above. Thiazide diuretic do not produce one of the following adverse effects. Hypoglycemia, false. Hyponatremia, true. True and true. So, answer is, they rather produce hyperglycemia. Hence, they are bad for diabetic patient. All of the following are the side effect of thiazide. Hypokalemia, true. Hypocalcemia, it's false. They rather produce hypercalcemia. Thiazides, they preserve calcium. Hepatic coma. Somewhat true, you can write. And impotency, true. They cause impotency. Mechanism of action of thiazide is, they inhibit sodium chloride symporter. They inhibit sodium chloride symporter. Okay. It is not sodium potassium, it's sodium chloride symporter in cortical portion of thick ascending limb. Complication of long-term thiazide. Metabolic alkalosis. The answer is absolutely true. Hypermagnesemia, false. They rather cause hypomagnesemia. Metabolic acidosis, false. It rather causes S-alkalosis. Acidosis is caused by acetazolamide-like drug. Hypocalcemia, false. They rather preserve calcium. So the answer out here is alkalosis. Okay. Thyroiditis can cause. Now, thyroiditis can cause impotency, we have discussed. Thyroid diuretic can cause all of the following. Hyperglycemia, true. Increased calcium excretion, false. Used in CHF, true. Decreased uric acid excretion, true. They cause hyperuricemia, hence the answer is yes. So, thyroids are used in all of the following except impotency. Okay, so they themselves causes impotency. They are used in diabetes insipidus, congestive heart failure and hypertension. Okay, now let's come to potassium sparing diuretic. So if you talk about potassium sparing diuretic, they act on late part of DCT and collecting duct. They inhibit the action of aldosterone. So either they inhibit aldosterone receptor by going inside the cell, or they will block the proteins, ENaC proteins, which are synthesized by aldosterone. So the drugs are mnemonic is SEAT, S-E-A-T, SEAT. So aldosterone receptor blocker is spironolactone and eplerenone. ENaC inhibitor are amiloride and trimetidine. Remember, spironolactone and eplerenone, they both have an active metabolite known as canrenone, which will produce this effect, which will block aldosterone receptors. Now remember, this is the only diuretic which will act from blood side or basolateral side, while all other diuretic, spironolactone and eplerenone, act from basolateral side. While all other diuretic, they rather get filtered from kidney, they come into the lumen of nephron, and then from the lumen of nephron, they will inhibit certain transporters. So all other diuretic act from luminal side. But remember, spironolactone, apart from blocking aldosterone receptor, also blocks testosterone receptor, spironolactone. Hence, spironolactone can cause gynecomastia and impotency, while in females, it can be used for the treatment of hirsutism. Okay, so remember this part. So let's talk about which diuretic. So if you talk about these potassium sparing diuretics, spironolactone, etc., remember, if you talk about their blood levels, remember, potassium sparing diuretic, they cause sodium loss, but they preserve all other ions. So they cause hyperkalemia. Potassium sparing diuretic causes hyperkalemia, metabolic acidosis, hypercalcemia, hypermagnesemia. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Let's talk about now the questions. So which diuretic could be considered appropriate for combining with ACE inhibitors? Remember, ACE inhibitors, they cause hyperkalemia. We have discussed in the unit of hypertension. So you must combine a drug which will rather produce hypokalemia. Remember, spironolactone is a potassium sparing diuretic. It also causes hyperkalemia. Eplerenone is also a potassium sparing diuretic. It causes hyperkalemia. Hydrochlorothiazide, remember, loop and thiazides. And carbonic anhydrase inhibitor, the first three diuretic, remember, they cause hypokalemia. We have already discussed. So they decrease potassium. Amiloride, again a potassium sparing diuretic, causes hyperkalemia. So the most appropriate agent to be combined with ACE inhibitor will be thiazides among them. Okay, because thiazides, they cause hypokalemia. ACE inhibitor causes hyperkalemia, which will neutralize each other's side effect. The spironolactone is contraindicated with, remember, they are contraindicated with ACE inhibitors because of the risk of dangerous hyperkalemia. ACE inhibitors also causes hyperkalemia. So among them, remember, ACE inhibitors, they end with the word pril. So try to find the drug, enalapril. Okay, so I'll just give you a complete list of our drugs which causes hyperkalemia. So the drugs are, you can write A, B, C, N, S. That is ACE inhibitors, beta blockers. Remember, here beta blocker is also an option. But remember, ACE inhibitors and potassium sparing diuretic, they can produce dangerous level. So second you will write cyclosporin. Then you will write NSAIDs. And lastly, spironolactone. Okay. Now, all of the following diuretic does not require presence in tubular lumen for its action. So it's asking indirectly which of the diuretic is acting from basolateral side. Remember, the diuretic which act from basolateral side is aldosterone receptor antagonist. that is spironolactone and eplerenone. So the answer out here is aldosterone antagonist. Potassium sparing diuretic, remember the mnemonic SEAT. Spironolactone, eplerenone, amiloride and triamterene. So spironolactone, triamterene, amiloride. So these are the drugs true. Ethacrynic acid is a loop diuretic. Bumetanide again is a loop diuretic. Long term use of which diuretic agent can lead to gynecomastia? The diuretic which causes gynecomastia is spironolactone. The reason is spironolactone blocks. Apart from aldosterone, it also blocks testosterone receptors. If testosterone or androgen receptors are blocked, it will lead to gynecomastia. The answer out here is spironolactone. Amiloride can cause hyperkalemia due to its action on, remember amiloride? It was ENaC inhibitor. So ENaC stands for, it was an ENaC inhibitor. Remember ENaC stands for epithelial or electrogenic, epithelial. That is epithelial sodium channels. Okay, so the answer is epithelial, which is sometimes known as electrogenic sodium channels. ENaC stand for. So answer out here is B. Amiloride differs from spironolactone is, remember spironolactone goes inside the cell of collecting duct and block the receptors of aldosterone, while amiloride, remember, it inhibits a channel on the surface of the collecting duct cell, principal cells, that is ENaC channel. Okay, this is the difference. So one of the following will act from basolateral site, it will come from the blood, and one will be filtered from luminal side, that is amiloride, that will act from luminal side, that we have already discussed. The answer for this question is it acts from the luminal side. Remember, amiloride acts from luminal side, spironolactone acts from basolateral side, that we have discussed. So all diuretic act from luminal side except spironolactone and eplerenone. Now let's discuss about the question number 8. The question number 8 is asking, all of the following statement about amiloride are true except it antagonizes the action of aldosterone. It's absolutely false. Remember, amiloride does not block aldosterone receptor. It is rather an ENaC inhibitor. Okay. So aldosterone receptor blocker or antagonist was spironolactone and eplerenone. It is the drug of choice for lithium-induced diabetes. It's absolutely true. It decreases loss of iron, calcium in urine. Absolutely true. It is most potent than triamterene. It's absolutely true. So let's see the treatment of diabetes insipidus. Electrolyte imbalance. Okay. So let's see the treatment. Okay. So let's see the treatment of this part. Just a moment. So if you can see, potassium sparing diuretic, they preserve calcium, they preserve all the ions except calcium, except sodium. They cause sodium loss while they preserve all other ions, hence they preserve calcium. So the C option is absolutely right. The second option is, are they used in the treatment of diabetes insipidus? It's absolutely true. This is the treatment of diabetes insipidus. So as you're seeing, amiloride is written that it is given in lithium induced DI. Remember, lithium gets absorbed from ENaC channels. So if you will inhibit ENaC channel, lithium will be lost out in urine. While all other diuretic, they increase the synthesis of ENaC channel because of more sodium delivered to collecting duct. They increase the expression of ENaC channel. So carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, loop diuretic and thiazide, they cause lithium toxicity. While lithium toxicity is inhibited by only amiloride. Okay, so remember this part. So let's come to the next question now. Eplerenone is, remember, aldosterone antagonist. Okay, it can cause hyperkalemia. It's absolutely true because it's a potassium sparing diuretic. It's a diuretic. It's absolutely true. Hence, the answer for this question is D. So all are correct. It's an aldosterone antagonist. Yes, it's a potassium sparing diuretic. That is why it will lead to hyperkalemia, and it's a diuretic. Which of the following is mineralocorticoid antagonist? Remember, SE, spironolactone and eplerenone. In cirrhotic ascites, we have discussed the drug of choice in cirrhosis of liver is spironolactone. Okay, We have discussed the treatment of edema. So the drug of choice in cirrhotic edema like ascites is spironolactone. Aldosterone action is on collecting duct. Okay. Potassium sparing diuretics act on aldosterone receptor or ENaC channels, any one of them. Either they inhibit ENaC channel or they block aldosterone receptors. Which of the following is aldosterone antagonist? The answer out here is spironolactone and eplerenone. So eplerenone. Triamterene causes. Triamterene, remember, is an ENaC inhibitor. Okay, it's an ENaC inhibitor and it is a type of potassium sparing diuretic. Okay, another example of this type of diuretic was amiloride. Okay, another example was amiloride. Now the question is asking, triamterene causes all of the following. Remember, it causes hypokalemia. It's absolutely true. Sorry, it's absolutely false. It rather causes hyperkalemia. Okay. Remember, hyperkalemia can lead to muscle cramps. It's absolutely true. It decreases urea level. False. It rather causes increase in urea level. Better glucose tolerance. False. Diuretics, they rather cause hyperglycemia. Now, canrenone is a metabolite of, we have already discussed, spironolactone. Okay. Spironolactone and eplerenone, their active metabolite is canrenone. Spironolactone is contraindicated with ACE inhibitor like enalapril. Why? Because of the dangerous risk of hyperkalemia. Spironolactone is effective in. Spironolactone, remember, it is the drug of choice in ascitic edema or the edema due to liver cirrhosis or liver failure. Okay? Because in liver failure, there is hyperaldosteronism. In liver failure, there is hyperaldosteronism. And hyperaldosteronism, more level of aldosterone is present in the blood. Okay? And if there is high aldosterone, we will give aldosterone receptor antagonist spironolactone. Lithium-induced DI, whenever the word will come, blindly mark the answer, amiloride. Because lithium gets absorbed back into the blood by ENaC channel. By ENaC channel, lithium, which was getting lost out in urine, comes back into the blood. So block this ENaC channel, lithium will be lost out in urine. Okay. Now hypercalciuria with renal stones are treated by, the answer is thiazides. Okay. So the answer for this question is thiazide, because thiazides, they preserve calcium. Okay. Now let's talk about certain questions of osmotic diuretic. So if you talk about osmotic diuretic, we have certain intravenous drug or oral drug. Intravenous, we have mannitol and urea. How do they produce action? That is completely given in our video series, whole concept. But for the exam point of view or for the revision size point of view only, this chart is important for you. So orally, that is isosorbide and glycerin. Remember, they are the drug of choice for cerebral edema. Okay. So they are used in cerebral edema. They are also the drug of choice for narrow angle glaucoma because they reduce the intraventricular pressure. They also reduce the production of aqueous humor in eye. They are also given in dialysis disequilibrium to maintain the osmolarity of blood. They can be given in impending renal failure to increase the renal blood flow. But remember, they are contraindicated in if the renal failure has occurred completely. They are also the drug of choice to remove cisplatin into the urine. They are the drug of choice for cisplatin toxicity. So in cisplatin toxicity, we give mannitol diuresis. We give chloride and mannitol. Okay. So they are the only class of diuretic which is absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. Because osmotic diuretic, they increase, they cause plasma volume expansion. Hence, they are absolutely contraindicated in heart failure. So keep this thing in mind. In a patient of cisplatin therapy, the following diuretic will be preferred. The answer is osmotic diuretic, that is mannitol. Okay. Which of the following diuretic is present in, not given in cardiac failure? The only diuretic which is contraindicated in heart failure is osmotic diuretic mannitol, because it can lead to plasma volume expansion. Plasma volume expansion due to high osmolarity will put more pressure on the heart to beat, pump more amount of plasma, which can further aggravate situation. Now, mannitol is not useful in, remember, it is given in narrow angle glaucoma. Yes, it is given in cerebral edema. It is given in impending renal failure. Remember, it's absolutely contraindicated in acute or pulmonary edema. Remember, pulmonary edema can also occur in heart failure. Okay. So, remember, it's never given in pulmonary edema. Now, let's talk about ADH hormone. Okay. So, if you talk about ADH hormone or vasopressin or antidiuretic hormone, it's a hormone synthesized by hypothalamus, supraoptic and paraventricular nucleus. It has three receptors, V1, V2 and V3, as the name by vasopressin. And they all are G-protein coupled receptors. Okay. V1A, V1, V2 and V3. Remember, V1 was earlier known as V1A and V3 was earlier known as V1B. They both are GQ type of receptors. They work by IP3 DAC, inositol, triphosphate and diacylglycerol, while V2 are GS type. They work by increasing cyclic AMP level inside the cell. V1, they produce vasoconstriction. That is why the word vasopressin have come. V2 is present in two locations, endothelial cell, where it increases synthesis of two clotting factors, one Willebrand factor and factor 8. And lastly, V2 receptor act on medullary portion of collecting duct of kidney, where it reabsorbs water from the collecting duct by formation of aquaporins. While V3 are present on pituitary, where vasopressin or ADH hormones stimulate ACTH release. Now, these are the drugs. So, some drugs which act on V1 and V2 receptors, they are vasopressin analogs. They are obtained from various natural sources, like human is arginine, swine is lysine, macropodis is fenipressin. And then we made certain synthetic drug known as V1 agonist and V2 agonist. V1 agonist is terlipressin. It is given for bleeding esophageal varices. Okay. It is given in resistant cases of shock and cardiac arrest due to catecholamines like epinephrine, norepinephrine. It is also given in hepatorenal syndrome to produce vasoconstriction in the body to remove. Now, V2 agonist, so terlipressin is only given IV. Then we have V2 agonist, that is desmopressin, which will only act on V2 receptors. Desmopressin is also known as DDAVP, that is desamino-D-arginine vasopressin. It can be given by many routes, but remember, intranasal route has been banned. So, it is only given oral or IV. It is given for neurogenic or central diabetes insipidus. It's the drug of choice. It's given for nocturnal aneurysms or bed wetting. And as it increases the synthesis of clotting factor 8 and 1 Willebrand factor, it is given in hemophilia A and 1 Willebrand factor deficiency. The side effect is, if more amount of water will be reabsorbed back into the blood by ADH or desmopressin, it will lead to dilutional hyponatremia. Dilutional hyponatremia leads to nausea, vomiting and seizures. Okay. So, what is the treatment of diabetes insipidus? So, this is the complete chart. Neurogenic diabetes insipidus means there is some defect in ADH hormone. Neurogenic means that neurons in the hypothalamus are not secreting ADH. So, there is no ADH in the body, hence supply ADH from outside. The drug of choice is desmopressin. Okay, so it's a very long acting formulation of ADH hormone. It's a synthetic drug. But if desmopressin is not given in the answer, you will mark the option as carbamazepine or chlorpropamide. These drugs, they increase ADH secretion from the brain. While there is another cause of diabetes insipidus, when the patient kidney is not responding to ADH. ADH is present in the body, but the receptors are not responding in kidney or nephron, that is known as nephrogenic DI. So here, remember, thiazides are the drug of choice. They have antidiuretic effect out there, but they are contraindicated in lithium-induced nephrogenic DI. In lithium-induced nephrogenic DI, amiloride is the drug of choice. Okay. So lastly, we have vasopressin antagonist also, which will block the receptor. Remember, these drugs, they will end with the word veptans. Agonist, they will end with the word presin. Antagonist will end with the word veptans. So, V1 and V2 antagonist, that is conibeptan. V2 antagonist is tolveptan, mozaveptan and lixiveptan. Okay. Remember, there is one antibiotic also, which also block V2 receptor. That tetracycline antibiotic is dimeclocycline. Okay. Where they are used? They are used in those conditions when the hormone vasopressin or ADH hormone is very high in the body. That condition is known as SIADH. syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Okay, so that can be seen in various organ failure like heart failure, kidney failure, and polycystic ovarian disease. Now there are certain drugs which are under trial: relcoveptan, belaveptan, and neliveptan. Okay, so this is all about the vasopressin antagonist. So let's solve the MCQs. So vasopressin antagonist, it acts on, remember, medullary portion of collecting duct, that we already know. Drug of choice for central diabetes insipidus or neurogenic. Remember, in neurogenic or central DI, ADH hormone is not produced, hence give ADH hormone from outside, that is desmopressin. Okay, which is wrongly matched vasopressin. V1 on vascular smooth muscle, it's absolutely true. V2 on distal nephron. Okay, it's absolutely true. V3 anterior pituitary, true. Remember, there is no such kind of receptor known as V4. There is no V4 kind of a receptor. Only V1, V2 and V3 are present. Drugs used in mild hemophilia. Remember, in mild hemophilia, we give desmopressin. DDAVP is another name of desmopressin. Okay? Because it increases the synthesis of factor 8 by acting on endothelial cells. All of the following drugs can be used for diabetes insipidus except amiloride, true. It is given for lithium-induced DI. Furosemide, false. It is not given. So amiloride, lithium-induced DI. Chlorpropamide, true. It is given in central DI. We have discussed carbamazepine, true. So the answer out here is loop diuretic. Loop diuretics are not given in diabetes insipidus. It is rather thiazides. Drugs causing gynecomastia. So the answer for this question is spironolactone. So let's write the complete list of the drugs which causes gynecomastia, which is important. First is digoxin, isoniazid, spironolactone, cimetidine, ketoconazole, and estrogens. So try to remember this list. Which of the following is the drug of choice for the treatment of SIADH, syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion? The answer is vasopressin antagonist. And I already told you there is one antibiotic which is a vasopressin antagonist, that is this. All vasopressin antagonists will end with the word Veptans. But Veptans is not given out here. Veptans are the drug of choice. But remember, demeclocycline. Demeclocycline is a tetracycline group of antibiotic which blocks vasopressin receptors. Selective V2 antagonist, agonist, used for the treatment of central diabetes insipidus. The answer is desmopressin. Okay, so desmopressin is the drug of choice for central DI. Okay, vasopressin decreases urine volume primarily by causing. The answer is it is acting on the medullary portion of collecting duct and increasing the reabsorption of water from there. So it increases in water permeability of collecting duct cells. Drug of choice for neurogenic diabetes insipidus is desmopressin. Vasopressin antagonist act on. So where vasopressin was acting? Medullary portion of collecting duct. Okay. Vasopressin cannot correct. Remember, I told you vasopressin or desmopressin are of no use in nephrogenic DI. Okay. Because in nephrogenic DI, the receptors of vasopressins are defective. Here the drug of choice is thiazides. While in lithium-induced nephrogenic DI, it's amiloride. They are given in neurogenic, yes, they are the drug of choice, that is desmopressin. Desmopressin is the drug of choice. GI bleeding, yes, we use terlipressin and vasopressin. Nocturnal enuresis, again the drug of choice for desmopressin, true. So they are not given in nephrogenic DI. So this is all about the diuretic parts and the kidney part. Hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much. For the complete videos, you can see the group. Okay, for the complete concept, the videos are there. You can see those videos. Okay, thank you very much.